Okay, so the agenda, going to the agenda slide. So I will start with a problem statement that describes the issues we see with the host control of the virtualized network interfaces. Then we'll quickly go over the features and properties that are exposed by standard NICs without I/O virtualization. Then I will go over the three different hardware-assisted I/O virtualization models and the set of properties and features that can and cannot be controlled in these three models from the host when the network interfaces are assigned to the VM or a container. Okay, we'll also talk about the switchdev mode and how it helps with the configuration of certain features with these models. If time permits, actually we'll go into some multi-home scenarios on how it complicates the configuration of certain features. And finally, I will conclude with a summary slide and some proposals on how to address the issues that we raised in the problem statement. Okay, so moving on. Okay, so this is the problem statement. Basically, in an I/O virtualized environment, the Linux networking stack and drivers do not provide sufficient hooks for a host system network administrator to configure, control, and monitor the network interfaces assigned to a virtual machine or a container, and that are composed from the NICs supporting hardware-assisted I/O virtualization. So basically, what you're saying is this becomes much more important in a cloud environment where a single NIC is virtualized and is shared across multiple tenant VMs. And the service provider would like to provide different levels of networking features and performance for different tenants and also possibly different VMs of the same tenant also. Okay. So going to the next slide. So basically, this just shows a standard NIC that can have one or more ports. And so each port is exposed as a single PCIe physical function on the host. And the PF driver running on the host creates a single netdev for each of these physical functions. And the VSI here actually represents a virtual station interface, or you can consider it as a switch port. But in this example, actually, it is directly connected to the uplink because there is no virtualization involved. So as you can see, actually, there is a one-to-one relationship between the uplink, netdev, VSI, and the physical function in this model. Okay, and all these netdev properties and features can be configured via NDVO ops that can be accessed from the user space via RTNet link API or via ethtool ops that can be accessed via the ethtool ioctls. So some of the features that can be controlled via NDVO ops are the MAC address, MTU, the additional MAC filters, or the VLANs, setting the promiscuous mode, or the transmit rate limiting. And similarly, with ethtool ops, we can control the stateless offloads, RSS configuration, the queue selection filters, and also the transmit-receive queues, and the descriptors, and interrupt moderation. Okay, so going on, the next few slides actually will go over the three different virtualized, hardware-assisted virtualized models. So starting with the SRIOV. So SRIOV is actually the well-known PCIe extension, and it is widely enabled. So in this mode, the PCIe device is partitioned into one or more physical functions, and each physical function can in turn support one or more virtual functions. Okay, so in this picture, we see basically we have one PF and two VFs connected by an embedded switch to the uplink. The first VF, VF1, is assigned to the VM directly via PCIe pass-through. And the second VF actually is, there is a host, the VF driver runs on the host for the second VF. and then it is assigned to the container via moving it to the network namespace of that container. Okay, so basically, but the one advantage in this model is the for both the VM and container case, the VFs can directly access the device. The data and control path can be directly accessed without any host intervention. So there are a couple of limitations with this model. So one is the limited scalability. So the number of VFs generally are limited by the PCIe spec because of this this requester ID limitation. So generally, you can have only around 64 to 128 VFs per PF. And the other issue is with the flexibility. So all these VFs generally, right, are created at the same time. And the resources also are allocated equally among all the VFs. So then the PF driver generally decides on the resource allocation. OK? So the next slide, actually, this shows the properties that and features that can be controlled by the PF. So via this NDO set VF and NDO get VF ops. So basically, currently, actually, we are considering this as a legacy ops, and they are expected to be frozen. So we are not expected to add more of these functions. So using these, we can actually control the MAC address, port VLAN, transmit rate limiting, link state, the spoof checking, and we can get the statistics. We can query the RSS information. We can enable or disable whether the VM can query the RSS information. And also, we can make a VF as a privileged one. So via the trusted function. Okay. So the next slide, actually, this one is the one that shows the features that cannot be controlled from the host. See, actually, it is not possible to add additional MAC filters or additional VLANs or switch filters when the VFs are assigned to a VM or a container from the host. And also the policy configuration, basically we cannot change the MTU or set a maximum level of the MTU or the, set a max on the number of queues that the VM can request for, or the descriptors or the interrupt moderation, the MSIX vectors, and also the port capabilities. So there is no way to control the capabilities of a VF that is assigned to a VM, like whether it can do promiscuous mode or RSS, or whether to support advanced features like crypto or RDMA. Okay. So this is all in the legacy mode. Okay. Now once we in the last few years we have the switchdev mode. So what this switchdev mode enables is basically it allows us to create these port representers, and the port representers enables us to create this additional ops on the port representer netdevs. So actually, in this picture, if you see, there is a port representer created per PF, VF, and uplinks. So actually, this picture shows two uplinks. And it is possible to create a bond or a team on these two uplinks to support a failover or link aggregation. Okay. Moving on. So the next slide, actually, this shows the features that can be controlled in the switchdev mode. So what we see here is that there are this switchdev mode actually provides an alternate way of controlling some of the features that were already possible in the legacy mode via this PF netdev. Now we have an additional way to control them via this port netdev. So specifically the port VLAN, transmit rate limiting, link state, stats, So there are two ways of controlling. And the additional max, the tagged VLANs and switch filters are the three new features that can be controlled in the switchdev mode, but that was not possible in the legacy mode. So, but even in switchdev mode, actually, we still are limited with the way the host can control the policy of the VF. Specifically, if you see all the features that are listed in red, the MTU or the receive queues, number of transmit receive queues or the descriptors, MSIX vectors, and the port capabilities, these we cannot still control even in the switchdev mode. Okay. So the next slide, actually this shows another IO virtualized, hardware assisted IO virtualized mode called VMDQ. So actually Alex talked about this model in the IO workshop yesterday. So basically this is enabled via the Mac VLAN offloads that he has been working on in the last couple of months to fix the issues with the existing implementation and also enable it for the other drivers. So in this model, what the PF driver basically it creates these virtualized interface via grouping of queues and associating them with the MSIX vectors and associating them to a VSI and along with a Mac VLAN filter. So in this model, basically, you can assign the virtualized interface to a container via the Mac VLAN, netdev, moving it to a network namespace. Or if you want to assign it to a VM, you have to go via Mac VTAP. So one negative about this mode is that if you are using, if you want to assign it to a VM, basically, you have to go through the host for the data path and control path, but for containers, there is a direct data path. Okay, and there is no hardware-based isolation here, so that's why we have to go via the host for the VM. But one advantage with this mode is basically it is more scalable than SRIOV. You should be able to create more VSIs in this model. Okay, coming to the feature configuration point of view, as you can see, there is most of the features, we don't have any way to control them in the legacy mode, because here we don't, the NDO set VF and the get VF functions that are available with SRIOV cannot be used here because they take a VF number. Okay, so the only thing that can be controlled is the MAC address that can be assigned before moving the device virtualized interface to the VM or a container. So how do we solve this issue? So basically, one thing is to introduce a switchdev mode for VMDQ. So what this, how this helps, basically we can create the port representer for the Mac VLAN and the Mac VTAP netdevs, and via these port netdevs, we should be able to control certain features. Okay, so here, this slide shows the features that can be controlled in the switchdev mode for a VMDQ. So yeah, it is essentially the same as the SRIOV via these port representer netdevs. And again, we see all these features that are in red cannot be controlled from the host. Okay. Yeah, okay, so then this is the new IO virtualized mode that has been recently announced by Intel called Scalable IO V. So this one we can consider it as an more scalable version of the SRIOV, where the it uses the mediated device framework that has been used for the GPUs. So using that, basically, it is possible to compose a VDEV in a more finer, granular manner. So where a VDEV can be composed via a group of assignable device interfaces. An assignable device interface, we can consider it as a transmit-receive queue pair. So you can group multiple transmit-receive queue pairs and then create a VDEV, and the mediated device framework can pass it to a VM via a virtual PCIe interface. So this isolation here is possible using the passive mechanism. So the future IOMMU and the devices are going to support this, and this should provide a more scalable version of IO virtualization model. So here we can have a direct data path to both the VM and the containers, and there can be a control and slow path via the host. Okay, so going to the features again, yeah, this slide looks similar to what we saw with VMDQ. Again, only the MAC address can be controlled from the host before it is assigned to the VM. All the other remaining properties and features, there is no way for the host to control them. Okay. So again, this one shows the scalable IOV in the switchdev mode. We can create the port representer netdev for each of these VDEVs. Okay. And then, this one, it shows the properties and features. Again, that can be controlled via the port netdev. And again, the features that cannot be controlled, they are all in red. So basically, the list is exactly the same as what we saw with VMDQ. Okay, maybe we'll come back to this multi-home later. So I would like to go to the summary slide. What we are saying is that the host admin does not have full control of the network interfaces that are assigned to a VM or a container in an IO virtualized environment. The switchdev mode helps via the port representer netdev. Currently what is happening is the PF driver is deciding the policy. So it is decides on the default parameters for the resource assignments when composing a virtual network interface. So what we need is a way for a system or network admin to configure per device default values and allowed limits for each type of the virtualized interface, and also per virtualized interface specific limits. Okay. And then here is the proposal. So basically what we are suggesting is to use devlink to configure this per PF parameters. So this should work with both legacy and the switchdev models. So for each of the virtualized network interface types. So for example, if you take an example as MTU, right? We should have a way to get the max that is supported by hardware, the default value, and the allowed max. And we should be able to change the default and the allowed max values. Similarly, for the in the case of the queues, right, where we cannot guarantee the number of queues that VF can request. So in such cases, maybe we should support this guaranteed min and a possible max, and then a way to set the default and the allowed max values. And the same thing goes with the interrupt moderation. We can have a hardware minimum that the hardware supports, and then support the do a get and set of the default and the allowed min value. Okay, the same goes with the MSIX vectors, the number of traffic classes, and the port. Yeah, in case of port capabilities, basically we should have a way to get the hardware capabilities and a way to get and set the allowed capabilities like these. Some examples are the promiscuous mode or the RSS configuration, the queue selection filters, and the crypto and RDMA capabilities. And this actually shows an example. So here, if you do a get for an SRIOV MTU, right, it returns a, let us say it returns a hardware max as 12,000, default is 1,500, and the allowed max also is 12,000 by default. But a user can, but the admin should be able to change the allowed max to 9,000. So that all the VFs, all the virtual interfaces created from that point onwards will get that value. And yeah, also as you see, you can see the receive queues example. So it is returning the guaranteed min as 1 and a possible max as 64. Default is 4 and allowed max is 64. So the admin can change it for VMDQ, okay, so yeah, for VMDQ it is returning allowed max as 16. So admin can change for SRIOV, the max is only 16. And similarly for VMDQ, you can change the default and also the allowed max. So the main reason to allow this via host admin is because he knows how many different types of virtualized interfaces he is going to create. So he has a better knowledge than the actual, having the policy in the PF driver itself, having some defaults. Okay, and similarly in the last section actually shows the port capabilities. So for example, the hardware could return that it can support promiscuous, RSS, crypto, RDMA. But the admin can limit the capabilities only to RSS or crypto, something like that. Okay, so these are per device capabilities. On top of this, what we need is a per virtualized interface policy also. So this can be done on the port netdevs in the switchdev mode. So basically on the port net devs, maybe we should be able to introduce new NDO ops to set, change the all these parameters, set the max for all these parameters. So that the per device defines the values for the entire, for the specific type of virtualized interface type, and this one specifies the limit for a specific instance. Okay. And then, yeah, this is another thing we'd like to propose. Currently, right, with the switchdev mode requires that a driver needs to support slow path. So basically, so that all the flow rules get programmed via the slow path. So this may not work for all the use cases, and it may not be scalable under load. I think basically it should be possible to use the port representers only for the exception path instead of having all the first packets of a flow to be handled via the slow path. So yeah, one option is to extend switchdev, introduce a new mode. So to switchdev called switchdev with no slow path. So it will just create the port representers and can be used as a control mechanism and the exception path mechanism. Okay. That's it, I guess. And then finally, any questions or comments?
Anybody?
So the purpose of this is to unify the management of all of these different things, not necessarily improve what the actual capabilities that you can change are, correct?
Yeah, so main idea is to manage, yeah. From a host to be able to control and configure these different type of virtualized interface type.
Okay. Yeah.
So you're proposing a mix of DevLink and NDOs, right?
Yeah.
For any reason, PF has a Netdev. Any reason you want to use DevLink via direct PCIe?
You mean instead of extended?
Defaults, to set the defaults. Those defaults are only for the VFs, is that?
Yeah, those defaults are for the virtualized interfaces.
And you set it on the PF PCIe device?
Yeah.
Okay.
PF PCIe device. Yeah, the, we could actually do it on the PF Netdev itself, but that requires adding new NDO ops on the Netdevs.
But you can't use the existing ones because you, this is a different default settings. And that's okay.
Yeah, one option is either you introduce new NDO ops on the PF Netdev or do it on via DevLink on the PCIe interface associated with the PF.
Okay.
So the possible maximum value on the when you're doing resource allocation, kind of I guess you're trying to address a case where you have some resources that you might want to share between VFs. Is that it?
Yeah. So actually, the thing is, it depends on how many VFs we are going to create. The max value can be, if you're creating only a fewer number of VFs, right, the max value can be a large value. But it may not be guaranteed. If you create a large number, say 64 VFs, you may not be able to use the possible max value. The hardware may not be able to support it.
So, like, is it that you dynamically, when you're requesting these resources, that's the only point where you don't actually requesting resources until you attempt to configure them?
Yeah, so the way to avoid that is basically to be able to let the admin change the allowed max. So if the admin knows that he's going to create 64 VFs, let us say, so he can change the allowed max to a lower value. So that the virtualized the VMs cannot ask for value that is larger than that.
Right, I guess my question is this. So if you go ahead and act, I assume that you're not guaranteed to be supplied this maximum value. Mm-hmm. It might fail. And that's probably because you have some resources on the host that you are allocating only at the time when they're requested.
Yeah.
So why do you defer that allocation? If that's kind of, if you actually request them on one VM, then another VM wants them, there isn't a way to ask the first VM to give them up, is there? So then you might end up to just partitioning statically after all.
No, so basically the admin knows how many VMs he's going to create in advance, right? So based on that number, he can change the allowed max. So that allowed max will limit the total number of, let us say, so we have a receive queues of 64. If a device, let us say, it supports only 64 receive queues. So it will say that the possible max is 64. But the administrator, let us say, he only going to create 16 VMs. So he can set the allowed max to 4.
But can you set that after you have requested some resources already? Or is it like initialization?
So the admin should be able to set it before creating any VMs.
then why is that like a possible max? Why would that allocation fail? Why is it a, there's like two maximum values, right, from what I remember from that slide.
There was a patch submitted by Broadcom recently to do something like that, where they were trying to add a new NDO, and so I think part of this was also incorporating that logic into here, where they had a similar thing where they were doing min-max, and it's like, why would you need min-queues? It's like, oh, well, that's actually the guaranteed number of queues that they're allowed. So that was part of it. Some of this is also, you know, based off of what we've seen some other vendors do as well.
One last question.
Regarding switch dev VM queues, what is the interface to create them? For SRIOV virtual function, we already have an interface, a way to create.
So that is the Mac VLAN L2 forward offload that
That's not for. I'm asking for switch dev. Yes.
Oh yeah, we don't have it the support yet. Basically, once if we enable switch dev mode with Mac VLAN interfaces, then it will create the port representers.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So when we tried to think about it, we had two suggestions to have kind of a dedicated interface like a devlink or something that's create another port, that's a VMDQ port, and when we are in a switch dev mode, it will create a netdev and a virtual and a representer for that. And another way, like you're doing in Mac VLAN, to extend the VTH to have a hardware support, hardware acceleration. So when you create a VTH and you can specify, okay, this can support a hardware, you can refer to which physical function it can be accelerated through, and then you don't have a represent, you have kind of two ports, that one of them is the representer and one of them is the actual VTH, and you can give him to modify the name, network namespace, and for give it to a virtual function, to a container.
So VEETH generally works with a bridge, right? I'm not sure, I'm not following how we want to.
Okay, so you don't have a suggestion how you want to create an interface.
Yeah, I'd say we'd probably end up looking at something more like the VEETH solution, like what you're suggesting, where basically it would just have to be somehow aware that, oh, I want to use the L2 forward acceleration logic like what Mac VLAN does, and that would end up being the easier approach. So then it also saves you from having to deal with some of the other issues. It just depends on which pieces we want to accelerate and which ones we don't in terms of the transmit path and such. So that's the only complication with using VEETH for something like that to do the acceleration, so.
Right.
Okay, any more questions?
Thank you.